All right, so that's going. So we're going to do a little bit of review today because I had a number of people approach me for clarifications and things, and I think that I went a little fast last week introducing these new tools. So we're going to start with the scenario that I guess we had last week where you've got a bunch of measures of IQ. And you've got them from two groups of people. So NS is going to be those slashes. People from Nova Scotia, people from BC are going to be these slashes. So with IQ, they're probably going to be somewhere around 100, but with some variability to either side. So I'm going to make up some fake data, obviously. So I'll make a bunch of NS people like this, maybe cluster them around maybe some central point here so that they, if you were to drop a histogram, that might form sort of a normal-ish distribution. And I might do the same thing for the BC folks. I'm actually from Nova Scotia, so I'm trying to sort of reverse any bias that I might have. So we can see that there's overlap in these distributions. You can see some sort of X's going on here. And we can go through and compute, okay, for the BC folks, where's their mean? So it might be around there. Call that 104. And with the NS folks, maybe it's right there. Call that 98. So we've got an observed mean for this group, an observed mean for this group. And we could actually just look at what the difference is. And it's 6. So, but as scientists, we're not interested in merely the sample that we've observed. We want to make inference with respect to some greater population. So in order to do that, we first need to express what our model for that population actually is. So I'll do that on a separate piece of paper. So a model of that population, again, put IQ scores on the x-axis, and we'll actually draw frequency distributions here. So we might expect that there's one group that follows a normal distribution with some mean 1 and some other group called mean 2. And it's possible that mean 1 and mean 2 are the same, in which case they'd be completely overlapping. I just happen to draw them so that they're separate and you can kind of see them. But they're both normal distributions. And I'll say that this group has some standard deviation called S1, and this group has some standard deviation called S2. So that's sort of a visual representation of this model for what we're saying, how the data were generated. If I wanted to go to a more code-like expression, I could say that the Nova Scotia group is distributed as normal, let's just say normal, N for normal, with a mean of mean 1 and variability or standard deviation of S1, and the BC group is normally distributed, the mean of N2, and the standard deviation of S2. So we actually used this model last time, and we've actually found that it was not really... It was a little bit cumbersome talking about mean 1 and mean 2, because when you have a model like this, again, either in the text like this or with a graph like this, the thing we're actually interested in as scientists isn't where this mean is and where this mean is, but actually is in the difference between the two means. That's the thing we're most interested in. I'll call that delta. So a useful trick is to what's called reparameterize the model to talk about not mean 1 and mean 2, but to talk about delta, which is the difference between these two, and I, which intercept, which is the sort of midpoint between the two. So we've got an intercept and a difference between the two means. So we can express that again in our text notation here. We can talk about Nova Scotia is distributed as normal. This time it's going to be the intercept plus some effect. And we'll stick with S1 and BC is distributed as the intercept minus some effect.
As you had it written, delta was the total difference. So
then yes, so we might say divide by 2. Divide by 2. Does that make sense to everybody? Because when you have, I'll actually put this on a separate piece paper. If I were to plot this data up so that IQ was now on this axis and group was on this axis, NS, BC, and I would put BC up there as their mean, that's the observed sample mean, and this is the Nova Scotia sample mean. The point halfway between these two. So that full distance is delta. So if I needed to go up to the point right between the two, that's I. That distance is I. And then if the full distance between the two points is delta, then to get from the intercept to one is delta divided by 2. And to get from the intercept to the other is delta divided by 2 as well. That fairly straightforward. So that's why in this reparameterization we have delta divided by 2. So both groups, in order to get to the mean for that group, you go up by the amount of the intercept, but then for one group you add delta divided by 2, and the other group you subtract delta divided by 2. Now, the way I've expressed this, NS, it's saying plus delta divided by 2, and BC is minus delta divided by 2, but in the little graph here that I showed you, BC is the higher point. So what's that going to do if what's going to happen now if I do the model and I've expressed the model as intercept plus delta for NS and intercept minus delta for BC?
Maybe like if BC is in fact the higher one, I think your final difference score would be negative.
Yeah, okay. So it actually won't screw up the math at all. It'll just change the sign of what delta is. Because if BC is the higher one, then plus delta will have to go down to get to the NS one. So delta will have to be a negative value, so plus a negative value. And minus delta is supposed to go up, so minus minus means going up. So it actually doesn't matter which one you say as plus or minus. One of them just needs to be plus or minus, and the math will figure out what direction things go. Yep?
Maybe this makes more sense when we're dealing with more than two means or two sets of data. I guess I don't understand how that is like easier or simpler than just looking at the means.
Gotcha. All right, so let's actually walk through maybe the analysis of when we had it as M1, M2, S1, S2. So regardless of what parameterization you have, for anything, any value in this that you're uncertain about, that you want to do inference on, you need to specify a prior on that. So I call this part of the model, whether it be this bit here where it's M1, M2, S1, S2, or this bit down here, intercept plus an effect, intercept minus an effect, I call this part the generative part of the model, because you've got sort of your data on one side of the tilde, and you're expressing a model for like how the data came about. You're uncertain about certain parts of the model, that is, what means each group had at the population level and what variability each group has at the population level. So to represent that uncertainty, you have to have a what's called a prior distribution. You have to specify a prior distribution for each thing you're uncertain about. So in both versions of the model, you're uncertain about four things. So I have this as S2 there. So S1 and S2, M1 and M2 in this version of things, intercept delta, S1 and S2 in this version of things. So how do we reflect that uncertainty? Make a little plot, and we'll deal with the M1, M2 scenario. So M1, M2. So we can think about IQ data like this, and we might decide that, okay, I want to take my... We know that 100 tends to be the value that would be most believable for regardless of what group people are. If we didn't have any prior biases to expect a higher IQ in one group or versus the other, and we additionally had the knowledge that IQ scores tend to have a mean of 100, then we would reflect that by having for both of these groups a peak credibility at 100 that tapers off on either side with some distribution. A normal distribution is useful. I intended to make these have the same amount of sort of slope on either side, so that would be parameterized as a variability. So let's call this normal with a mean of 100 and a variability of, I don't know, 30. And same thing over here. Normal with mean of 100, variability 30. Having expressed our prior distribution for the means, we also have to do the same thing for the standard deviations. So with the standard deviations, there's like a hard limit of zero in that you can't have any credibility down to zero. So it makes sense to have a distribution that drops to zero as it approaches zero. Using our knowledge again of IQ scores, we can say we probably want it peaked somewhere around 15. So if I say 15, peaked around there. But we can have sort of a distribution that looks kind of like that. It's usually a distribution that's a little bit more skewed than the normal distribution. And I'll go like that. I can't remember what we used last time. But for this, a Weibull with shape 2, so a Weibull distribution can create a nice... drops to zero at zero, but has this skewed shape. 2 and I think 20 was one that we found. I gave you some code to work out what like values yield what shapes, and I think we decided that 2 and 20 was one that had a peak that was around 15. Yeah.
You probably want it to be around 30 for this example, though, right?
Or
no?
Well, let's actually take a look.
Oh, okay, sorry. So your 30 up at the top is not variability of the mean, it's your credibility.
Yeah,
okay,
so
okay,
this
sorry.
30 here, again, reflects like with a mean of 100 and standard deviation of 30, about 64% of the mass of credibility is within 30. So there's 130 and there's 70 is within one standard deviation of the mean there. So you still reflects the sort of reasonable credibility out to like 140, 150, which are actually pretty extreme values. So 30 leads to a fairly slow tapering off of belief relative to the scale that we're familiar with in terms of IQ. And when you have a belief that tails off slowly like that, it's called a weakly informed. If we were really certain that it was precisely 100 for each of these groups, we'd have a much smaller number, and so it would tail off very quickly on either side of our peak belief. So down here, we'll use 20, and that makes it so that we have, there we go, a shape, skewed shape. It's peaked at about 15, but like 30 is still reasonably credible, and 40 is still reasonably credible. And the way we did it, or at least the way we've expressed it here, is that we're allowing each group to possibly have its own amount of variability. So that's a little bit different from the frequentist tools that you would have been taught with, like a t-test, where it assumes that both groups have the same amount of variability. Now, I showed you how you could actually make that assumption of equal variance, and that would be not to have S1 and S2, just have something called S, and have a single prior on that, in which case when you expressed your model, you wouldn't have S1 and S2, you just have S in the same spot for both of those. But it's relatively trivial to allow the extra flexibility that the potential for two different amounts of variability within the population can afford. And you can actually ask the question, is there a difference between the two populations with regards to how variable they are within themselves? So with this part of the model, saying that, okay, the data is structured like this, and these are our priors for each of the things that are uncertain in our generative model, you can take that and you put that in a stand file. You then take your data that you actually observed here, and tell R to take the stand file and the data and combine them together to tell you about what you should believe now. So if this was what you expressed as reasonable beliefs before seeing the data, what should you believe now that you've seen the data? So the result is, again, it's going to be four plots. Where the plots now reflect sort of the degree to which a given value on the axis is believable. So for this mean, it's going to have some distribution, and where maybe this is 100, it's probably going to be pushed towards what the sample mean was. So maybe it's peaked at, the sample mean we said was 98, so maybe it's peaked at around 99. And this is the mean for the other group, and it had a peak at, okay, that's 100, it had a peak at about 104, so maybe the posterior will be peaked at around 103 or something. And similarly, you'll have a distribution for each of the variability parameters. So this one will be peaked at around, I don't know, 15. And I actually can't remember what these were. I think I made one more variable than the others. So this one peaked at like 8. So for each of these things that you were initially uncertain about, you'll now have a representation where you're still uncertain, but you've updated your uncertainty to be informed now by the data that you've observed. So you can express, okay, well, my peak value for belief in where M1 at the population level is, what the population, if M1 was the Nova Scotia folks, we're talking about what the mean of all Nova Scotians is about 99. And you can express also sort of the credible interval for this. So you'd find, you'd sort all your observations in the samples from this M1 distribution, and you find the 2.5 percentile and a 2.5 percentile and 97.5 percentile. And you find the range that that those two values express. So it might be from like 96 to, if I try to make that symmetric, 102. I'm just making up numbers here. So that gives you that 95% credible interval, expresses where the majority of the most credible values for that parameter lie. Somewhere between 96 and 102. Ditto, you can do the same thing for M2. So call something like that. So 107 to 99. So this now gets us to the question, what can we now say about our data just from these representations? Well, we can say that this group's peak point of credibility is around 99, but the mass of credibility is between 96 and 102. So the population mean is probably somewhere between 96 and 102. Ditto, this group's peak is around 103, and the majority of credibility is between 99 and 104. What did I put there? 107. But having gone through this whole process, this isn't giving us the answer to a question that I think we would find most interesting, which is, what should we believe about the difference between these two populations? Because in theory, if we went ahead and measured these two populations, presumably we're interested in not just the population's values all by themselves. Could have done that in just one model for each population. But if we're doing them together, presumably we're actually interested in the difference between the two populations. So that's why we started working with this other parameterization, where we have the intercept and effect.
So like in the first version, you can just subtract one population from the other and get to the difference.
Yes, so I showed you a way to go in and actually say, okay, grab one sample from this mean, this distribution, this set of samples from the posterior, and subtract it from one observation from this one, store that away, and repeat for everything, single sample, pair of samples that you have, in which case you then get a distribution of different scores. You could do that. That means that you're doing things by hand that you didn't necessarily need to do.
Yeah. So I was just going to say, like any other way, you can also get it to tell you the means as part of its printout, so they're kind of equivalent, it's just a matter of which one you prioritize.
Yes, exactly. And
is it more common to do it with the
intercept? So it's more common to do it the intercept effect way, because the immediate thing you get as a printout for like the credible intervals for your parameters gives you the thing that you're actually interested in. And it's also easier to think about the priors that you're going to apply. So going back to the priors that we applied when we had the mean one, mean two, to implement a prior that expressed zero difference between the two groups, we had to just use the same prior for both groups. But it's uncertain when we say, okay, this group has a prior of 130, and this group has a prior of 130. What does the prior, what does the that sort of matching of the priors for the two groups imply for the prior, the implicit prior where we have on the difference? Well, certainly it means that the difference, the implicit difference prior is peaked at zero, but how does it fall off on either side? It's not, well, it's just not explicit. It is often useful to be, to use the intercept difference parameterization because you can be explicit about the prior that you're putting on that difference score, the thing that you're actually interested in. It's also useful because it makes it easy to move from these precise numbers that we're using here as numbers informed by our previous experience with IQs specifically to weakly and still weakly informed priors, but that are drawn, that are influenced by the data in a way that I'll elaborate in a moment. What should I show first? Let's go to just talking about the intercept effect model and working through, again, setting the priors and then getting the posterior. So with the intercept effect model, that's the one on the bottom here, we again have four things we're uncertain about: intercept effect, S1 and S2. I think when we switched to this model, I got lazy and I just had this as just S last week, if you go back through the files. Just for doing it on paper here, I'll leave it at S1 and S2.
Yeah, I think when we realized that we were just using the same information for both, that we set it as the same.
I think I was just being lazy. Right? Yeah.
That would be like if you had homogeneity.
Yes, yeah, so again, to specify our priors for this model, we've specified sort of the generative part of our model here, where you say one group is distributed as this and the other group is distributed as this, but this has some uncertainty, or some parameters over which we're uncertain, so we have to express our uncertainty. So for the intercept, I would express some distribution. For the effect, that express some distribution, and then S2 and S1 similarly. So S2 and S1 are going to be the same as before, some sort of Weibull, maybe a shape of 2, and the other parameter on the Weibull is called a scale, so 20. That will peak at somewhere around 15. So S1 and S2 is going to be treated exactly the same as before. If we have time today, I'll show you a different way of doing things that, in the same way that we're moving to intercept and effect for the means of the population, we'll do the same thing, intercept and effect for these variabilities. But for now, we're just going to have S1 and S2. So for the intercept, we can again use our familiarity with IQ scores and just say, and just let me remind you, the intercept again is if we had a plot of groups and S, B, C, and this is the IQ score, and this were the population mean of NS, and this were the population mean of BC. which we don't actually know. We just have sample means for those two groups. The intercept would be the halfway point between the two. And this delta thing is the distance between the two. So another way of thinking about the intercept is thinking about what would be your prediction for the mean if you didn't know which group you're talking about. You didn't know either of the groups, didn't have the labels for the data. So a good guess for IQ on the intercept would be to peak it at 100 and to have it sort of tail off on either side of 100 with some... This doesn't look normal whatsoever, but usually would you use a normal. So normal, 100, and maybe 30 to describe sort of where we think our intercept is. And for the effect, we went out and did all this effort to collect all this data. So presumably something motivated that, in which case we probably have a prior that is not peaked at zero. But for the purpose of your potentially skeptical peer reviewer, you probably want to have an effect that a prior on your effect that's peaked at zero. And then we'll express it as with a normal distribution, peaked at zero, with some tapering off. So I don't know. Maybe we'll use 30 because we use 30 over here. 30 is a really big number relative to, we know that the amount of variability within a given group is going to be around 15-ish. So 30 is sort of on the scale of the amount of variability we typically observe within a group. So this would be our set of priors for this intercept effect scenario. And taking our parameterization down here, our generative model plus our expression of priors, and shoving together our data will yield yet another 4x4. So here, S1 and S2, they're going to be similar as before, peaked at some values, not super interested in those. For the intercept, it's probably going to be peaked somewhere around 100 or wherever. It's going to be pushed from its previous peak of 100 towards whatever the actual literal center point of the data were. I don't remember what that value was. Actually, it was, what did we say? It was 98 and 104, so it would be 103? No. 101. So it wasn't super far away from 100 in the first place, but it will also narrow up, reflecting that we've seen data, and now we're more confident about the value of where the intercept is. And if we are interested in actually like computing the 95% credible interval, we could do that. So it's peaked at, say, 101 now, and the credible interval is, say, 98 to, what did I say? Well, let's call it 96 to 106. but, I mean, this intercept term is not super interesting by itself. Kind of establishes where the groups were overall located, but the more interesting thing is this difference. So we would have started with a peak at zero. The peak is going to move towards whatever the observed difference is. The observed difference was 6, so if we put 6 over here, it's probably going to be somewhere over here. But it's going to critically narrow up relative to what that what our prior was. So now we can ask what's its credible interval, And the way I've drawn it, 0 actually is included here. In the data set that we used the other day, 0 didn't fall within the 95% credible interval. So if 0 falls inside the 95% credible interval, one way of summarizing that data is to say 0 is not amidst the sort of most credible values for this parameter delta, the difference between the two groups. Which one did I just say? 0 is? Or?
I think
it's
you
not.
Just said one way to report a difference would be to say 0 isn't.
Okay, so if 0 is outside that range, so let's say the range is 1 to 10. If the range were 1 to 10, peaked somewhere around 5, 0 is not within the sort of central 95% credible values for the value of this parameter. So you could go ahead and act as if 0, that you no longer assign any credibility to 0, even though there actually is a little bit of credibility out here. The amount of credibility out here is so small, you might as well discount 0. So that's the same as in your frequentist world as coming up with a significant result. If 0 is still inside this 95% credible interval, so maybe this goes from negative 1 to 10, then 0 remains sort of a credible, a relatively credible value. So that would be analogous to your non-significant result.
Say it was still in the tail left end, you could still say under Bayesian stats, it sounds like that, you know, like 78% of the credibility is a positive value, not 0.
Yeah, you could actually go in and actually compute what is the percentile value for 0 and express that as well. I mean, technically, the full Bayesian result is this full distribution.
Yeah.
How you then go on and choose to summarize that for your reader and make decisions with regards to what experiments to do next is a non-Bayesian thing. The standard is to at least express the 95% credible interval so that people coming after you and doing Bayesian meta-analyses can use that information to aggregate data. But,
and I know you said one of your sort of Bayesian gurus actually favors a 50%.
But that's in a slightly different context that we might get to today, but I don't think so. It's becoming sufficiently common now that you would, I mean, an ideal scenario for any statistics, whether you're doing Bayesian or not, is that you have a reproducible workflow such that you can actually have at least the script for the data analysis, if not the script and the data, available in an appendix for download. For a quick summary, you'd typically say you used weakly informed priors. You wouldn't actually say normal 130. You wouldn't bother saying that. You just express that you had weakly informed priors and trust that the peer reviewers would double check the code and see, okay, they agree that 130 is weakly informed. And you'd express the model. You'd express that you sort of treated each group as having a normal distribution with some unknown parameters and express that you had weakly informed priors for each of the parameters. You wouldn't need to go in like the full detail, particularly if you had the code in the appendix.
Just getting back to another question, though, it seems like with a p-value, you can't make any claims based on a higher p-value than 0.05 if you've set that as your alpha.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with this, you kind of can message.
First of all, you say you can't, but people do. you can kind of take the same, you can apply the Neyman-Pearson type approach to this and have that strip cut off. Or, I mean, Usually, I would be very wary of any results that are right on the borderline anyway. And if I saw somebody trying to assert something that's coming from like a 75% credible interval and not a 95, I'd be suspicious of why they chose that. And it's probably because it wasn't, it didn't exclude zero at the 95. So I think you get, I mean, I say you can describe the results that way. It's, I'm not going to say it's not Bayesian, because anything that tries to take the full posterior and summarize it is technically moving outside the Bayesian world. Technically, the result is the full posterior. But how you then, as humans, communicate it to one another is up to, I guess, what people are used to and the social circumstances.
Yeah, maybe one other question before we move on, too, is when you look at the difference, the I guess the prior for the difference score for the delta, and you set the standard deviation as 30, that seems like a really high, like even higher in meaning than setting the standard deviation of the, say, like, intercept.
Okay.
Just trying to, like, wrap my mind around.
So referring to when we're using the intercept effect model,
yeah,
and we're establishing the priors,
yeah,
for each of the four parameters, S1 and S2 down here, but they're not very interesting, so let's focus on intercept and effect. So you felt it was relatively straightforward to have sort of a nice big 30-point variability here.
It's double what we would expect from the normal IQ anyway.
And an effect, they're prior on the effect here. Are you concerned that this value is too big?
Well, it just seems like that's a different kind of 30 than the other one, because this is like a different score, which you wouldn't, unless you had some prior knowledge, you're not expecting a huge difference. But if you set standard deviation as 30, then you're encompassing such possible different scores.
Yep.
That's correct.
So what you're saying is that like you'd actually be much more confident that the differences should be close to zero, like that. Maybe a distribution like this. So the distinction in terms of what ends up happening, what you get out as a posterior distribution, is that the wider your prior distribution is, the more influence the data has. Which, in theory, is like a better scenario. So even if you're like, even if you are fairly, like you don't actually, let's call this 30 and let's call this like 60. You actually don't believe a difference of, between two groups of 60 IQ points. So that really should be down to zero if you were reflecting your beliefs honestly. Remember again, we're not reflecting our beliefs honestly already because we are centering the distribution at zero. So we're already doing one thing to kind of fudge our beliefs to be acceptable to an audience. So what that one thing is to make it so that it's peaked at zero. And the other thing is to make it like reasonably wide or maybe even unreasonably wide. Now, I tend to try to make it so that it's about as, it's in the same order of magnitude as the, so this is a parameter that's describing a difference between means in two groups. I try to express my prior uncertainty on the same order of magnitude as the amount of noise I'd expect from a given group. So with IQ, it tends to be around 15. So 30 is 2 times 15. So it's still on the same order of magnitude as 15. If we wanted to push that down to 15, it probably would yield largely the same result. If we pushed it down to like 1, that would make it very hard for the data to move the belief away from zero towards what the data actually say. And that would be sort of, that would reflect much stronger skepticism, but can get into the realm of starting to ignore data. So it's better to err on the side of a value that's too big in terms of uncertainty than a value that's too small and therefore conveying much more confidence.
So you put your difference scale on the same as like normal noise scale in data. I mean, even though that's not what you really just be on the same side. And those two theories aren't really like equivalent to one another. They're both just like units of
Yeah, well this 30 is saying like sort of you still believe a intercept of about 130, which is kind of ridiculous, and an intercept of 160 actually is still relatively credible, and that's somewhat ridiculous. Ditto, an effect size of 60 is somewhat ridiculous. So in the sense that they're both somewhat unreasonably credulous, they're kind of the same.
Yeah, I mean, but you could just as easily make the top left one like 100 and 300 or something. It seems like that would be closer to the proportions of like the numbers that you're dealing with because you have a different score of like 6 and you have an intercept of 100.
Oh, okay.
In theory, you can just make it straight because then it's really not driving your posterior.
Yes. Well, I don't think the actual absolute value of this scale, you're talking about like that this are numbers from 0 to like negative 60 to positive 60, whereas this one starts way up at 100.
Well, I'm kind of reading into the number that came out too in the end.
Mm-hmm.
Your final intercept is like 101 or 102,
yeah,
which is a big number, and your final difference is like 6, which is a small
yeah
number. So like units of information
yeah
seem to matter.
Yeah. No, that's right. So that actually leads into a little bit of the next thing we kind of nuanced our model with, which was so far we've been using like numbers that we came up with given our expertise in the field of IQ, and that's a pretty well established, that IQ has well established psychometric properties such that we kind of expect in most populations the mean to be about 100 and the amount of variability we see in the population, the standard deviation being about 15. But what if we had some data from a scale where we actually didn't have that knowledge? What do we do then in terms of having to go through this process of Bayesian data analysis where we have to express prior beliefs for things where we don't have a lot of... So I'm going to show this IQ data again. And I want you guys to pretend that you're first years and you've never been exposed to IQ and you have no idea what's going on, what these values are. Well, I lie, because first year, yeah. Let's say somehow in your career as psychologist, you've never been exposed to IQ scores, but you've been exposed to all sorts of other things, droop, cognitive decline and aging, and a whole bunch of other things. Something that's common across your experience with all those other things in the domain of like effects that we as experimenters can have on the behavior and the psychology of our subjects can be summarized by effect size. So if you think of like through all your papers and things, you would probably be, if you found an effect size of 3, you'd probably be pretty impressed, surprised. In fact, you wouldn't believe an effect size of 3. If you saw an effect size of 0.4, that seems more characteristic of our field as psychologists. 0.1, you'd be like, okay, well, they found, good for them, they found a small effect size. They must have had a high end to find that small effect size. But there's plenty of small effect sizes out there in our field. So you guys actually do have an intuition of effect sizes that we can use to bootstrap intuition for a given sort of sub-measure in your field that will be our way of establishing priors more generically and sort of unthinkingly. So what is an effect size, though? So typically, effect size, I'll give you a hint, it's a ratio. Okay. You said it's a ratio. It's difference explained by a model compared to... so I'll call it difference model over what?
So the variability?
Okay, so it's variability. Oh, maybe you...
I thought the variability went on the bottom.
Okay, but variability of what?
Within the data.
So if you just say variability of the data, I guess another way of saying that is with like no model, like or like the simplest possible model, which is no predictors, you just have data with some amount of variability in it. And the thing that goes on the top is some measure of, now there's different effect sizes that you can get, Cohen's D and all sorts of other ones, but the general structure is that you have variability, that is explained by your model, and that is some proportion of variability that is explained by the data. You can actually get, so the way I've expressed it here, it looks like you can only get as high as one, but there's ways of expressing these, like the magnitude of a difference you observe between two means relative to the magnitude of variability that you have within each group. That's a way of expressing it where you can get more than one. So let's take a look at our data again. You somehow managed to collect data on IQ, but you don't have a good sense as to what the psychometric properties of IQ are, what to expect. But you do know that you can actually look at your data and see, oh, there's this variability here, big bunch of variability. And maybe you ignore a group and you find out that your standard deviation here is 14. I'm going to put it, you happen to luck out and you get precisely 15 for your standard deviation. It makes the math work out a little bit easier. So, when you have it like that, you can convert each of your numbers to a Z-score. Again, using the mean of the whole group to establish the sort of the zero point. So you'd have this group is, I guess, what would it be, -3. So this group gets turned to -3, and this group gets turned to +3. So the difference between them is going to be 6, 15, and still 6, but I haven't then z-scored, which is divide that by 15, divide that by 15, right? So the difference, the scale, the intercept ends up being set to 0, and whatever this difference is gets expressed as an effect size. Does that sort of follow you guys? It's an effect size relative to the amount of variability you've observed in the entire population ignoring group. So now instead of a mean of 98, a mean of 104, and therefore a difference of 6, and a center of 101, you now will have a center of 0, an effect size, or a difference of 0.33, and a total amount of variability of 1. That's what happens if you've converted everything to z-scores. The standard deviation of the observed sample will be turned into 1. So, having done that rescaling of the data to z-scores, allows us to then specify our priors. We still have the same generative model. That is, we could use either of these models, normal with mean 1, mean 2, or the intercept effect, let's go with the intercept effect version of things. But now when we express our priors for those terms in that model, we can express them on the effect size scale. So with the intercept, it's pretty easy because we actually fixed the, by standardizing the data, we set the center point between the two groups at zero. So it's reasonable to have a normal peaked at zero. And even though we've done this mathematical operation to peak, to make the sample mean precisely zero, we're uncertain as to whether the population mean, it could be something other than zero. So it's still important to include a bit of credibility for non-zero values. The posterior will actually still be centered on zero because that's what the sample is. Usually the posterior moves towards the sample mean, but since the sample mean is precisely zero, it's not going to move at all, but it'll tighten up. So normally I use normal 0, 1. And again, because we've done z-scores, 1 reflects one standard deviation of the population, which was 15. So normal 0, 1 here is the same as doing normal 101 and 15. Now, before we had normal 130, so we had slightly different prior when we actually were using knowledge that we had about IQ scores. But it's fairly similar in terms of the overall shape, and it's probably not going to make much cause. We'll probably get a very similar posterior out.
Would be closer to do 0.2?
Yep, if you wanted to do 2. As I said, you probably want to just... I try to use priors on the same magnitude as the noise you observe. So precisely the same magnitude would be 1. If you wanted to be a little bit more cautious, you could put a 2 there. Again, bigger values within reason won't hurt. And like, if you put this as like 0.1, that would express maybe a unreasonably confident prior. Anything above like 1 and between 1 and 10 are probably all going to yield about the same posterior. So
maybe like the 2 parallels 30 given that.
Yeah. Yeah, so if we actually wanted to emulate the value of 30 that we had in the unscaled version, we'd put a 2 there. I get lazy and I put normal 0, 1 everywhere.
Sorry, it's going to be relatively on the form. Why didn't you choose a standard deviation of 15 initially?
Do you mean way at the very beginning when we were pretending to be certain about the standard deviation? We put 15 here.
Sorry, because I thought we started off as being very naive about...
Yes, but we could actually look at our sample and get a sense of the standard deviation that's actually in the sample itself.
Gotcha.
So we use the sample to inform our belief about the magnitude of noise. But having done that, that then simplifies... what we need to do here to establish our representations of belief for these other parameters. So for the effect, again, we want to be peaked at zero, probably use a normal distribution to reflect the tapering off credibility on either side of zero. And in the same way that normal 0,1 over here reflects sort of a relatively uninformed prior on the intercept, normal 0,1 on the effect also makes it so that sort of the more credible values are still, I mean, we tend to deal with effect sizes much less than 1 in our field. So you still have credibility for unreasonably large values, which is okay for... as long as it's sort of in the same order of magnitude as the noise there.
So this is forcing delta to also be effect size because you divide
by the same. Yeah. So this actually literally means that if you want to get your computation of effect size out, it's there. I say that, as Ghislain brought up the other day, he actually asks specifically that question. If you want actually a credible interval on the effect size itself, you'd need to do something slightly different. Because the effect size, we've scaled things to make our priors easy, but as indicated by these two empty boxes, we actually want to do inference on what S1 and S2 is. We'd still make them have this hard bound at zero. And I think I had you guys use a Weeble with shape 2, scale 1, and that tended to put the peak a little bit less than 1. So let's imagine that there were no differences between the two groups. So we'd end up with a posterior centered on 0, tight around 0 for this delta. If that's the case, then the amount of variability we observed across the two groups, or across all the data ignoring groups, should be about the same as the amount of variability that we observe within each group. So that would mean that the peak credibility value for either of these values should be about 1. 1 meaning 15. 1 on the Z scale reflecting 15 on the original scale. So that's why we want something peaked near 1, 1-ish.
Sorry, I didn't follow that. So you're saying if there's no effect, then we can also assume the standard deviation?
Well, I was just describing that if there was no effect, if there is no actual difference between the two groups, then the standard deviation that we observe ignoring group is probably going to be about the same as the standard deviation, as the mean standard deviation we observe within any given group. So if there's really no difference between the two groups, this standard deviation of 15 across the groups should be about the same as if we went in one group and observed its standard deviation and looked at the other group and observed its standard deviation. So that's what motivates us having priors for the standard deviation that are peaked at about 1, i.e. about the value we observe as noise when we ignore group altogether.
If we do find different standard deviations across the group, we can
then express the effect. Which standard deviation are you like? You're just doing it on the overall amount of noise across all the groups. And it's not going to matter too much if I actually have code ready to talk about the scenario where there is a real difference between the two groups in the amount of variability they manifest. But that shouldn't affect this stuff too much, this sort of scheme of achieving these nice default priors. So with these default priors, we again take our model specification, intercept and effect, we combine with the priors that we observe, put that up together in a stand file, scale the data, and then shove that data. So we turn the data to z-scores and give that the stan. I actually showed you a way to scale within stan itself last week. But if you feel like scaling outside, that's fine too. And the result you'll get out is, again, distributions for what you should believe having seen the data. So for the intercept, you actually scaled it so that the sample was, you had a prior peak at 0, but the sample also had a precise mean of 0, so your peak is still going to be at 0, but it's going to firm up around that value, and we're not super interested in the intercept in the first place, so we don't really care too much about that. The one we do care about is the effect, and we had a prior peak at 0, but we have 1 here, negative 1 here. We would have observed something, I think it was a 0.3, is the observed peak. So we'll have a posterior that's shifted towards the observed value. and we can then compute what the credible interval is and establish whether zero remains credible, remains in that interval after updating our prior with the data, or whether zero has become incredible given our data.
I want to change that delta back to the units of the data, what you multiply it by.
Yep, so you just multiply it by the thing that you originally divided by, which is this observed standard deviation we observed in the sample, so 15. So you just multiply this by 15. And I showed you guys how to actually do that by hand outside in RStan, sorry, in R, but also how to make it so that you generate a thing. I think typically this delta we called coef or diff, and I showed you how to make it so that it actually automatically did that in RStan. It automatically unscaled, so you had something called coef unscaled, so that you could have Stan automatically both scale and unscale when you were done. Does that make sense? So that brings us up to just this general idea of, that's a quick review on what we're doing with Bayesian analysis of two samples in the first place, and how you can go from the two means to an intercept and effect, and how you can make use the data, the amount of variability you observe in the data, to make your job of specifying priors a little bit easier and sort of more standardized. We spent a lot of time on the Wednesday working from this generative model. Starting out with a generative model where we had sort of it clear on two lines of code. The Nova Scotia group is distributed as this. The BC group is distributed as this. And then saying, okay, let's go to the intercept effect model, but still as two different lines, to introducing a way of simplifying just your code of expressing this model that I promised would have benefits down the line. So here we have, again, two lines. Let me actually start it on a whole new piece of paper. So we have, I'll call it one. NS distributed as normal, intercept plus effect, and I was being lazy. We just had the single unknown or single variability parameter, so we imposed a homogeneity of variance assumption. We will possibly have time to look at that today, if not on Wednesday. So, and then BC, normal, intercept minus effect, S. So this way of doing things required us, when we were providing data to the Stan function in R, to have it separated out, like here's the NS group and here's the BC group. A different way of expressing this exact same model mathematically is to, instead of having two groups, like a bunch of IQs for Y in one vector and a bunch of IQs for BC in another vector, is to have one single long vector. Let me actually start the model here. I'll grab another piece of paper. So for model one, it wanted the NS IQs. So it'd be like 102, 97, 104, 107, etc. in one vector. And then it had the BC ones in a whole separate vector, 106, 102, 99, 98, blah, blah, blah. So we gave it these separate sort of objects to represent the two groups separately. With the second way of doing things, we have we're giving it two vectors. One vector is the IQ, and the other is like a group indicator. So IQ, again, we had 102, MS, 104, BC, 97, MS, 102, BC. Da, da, da. So, and this is how actually the data was structured in our data set. You usually have it such that you have sort of one column that's a score, another column that's a predictor. Maybe you have other predictors in your data set, whether the participants were male or female, or what their age was, that sort of thing. So it can be cumbersome. It's simple enough when you've got just two groups to structure the model like this so that you just batch together all the scores from one group into one thing and all the scores from the other group into another thing, and then structure your model so that you've got two different lines of code expressing how the parameters combine to get to each group's mean. But when you start to get to more complex models, this becomes cumbersome. Got a question over here?
Is it delta over 2, or did that?
Yes, yeah, sorry.
Okay,
yeah,
no,
I keep
wanted to make sure I wasn't.
No. Yeah. So I showed you a second way of doing things that allowed you to take in the data that looks kind of like this. What we actually had to do was create a dummy variable over here, coding whenever you saw NS here into, say, negative 1, and whenever you saw BC here into positive 1. So negative 1, positive 1. So let's call that X.
Can we also like, make it 0.5 to get rid of it over 2 or something?
Yeah, so instead of positive 1 and negative 1, well, I'll get to that in a moment. To show you. So when we've got a list of IQ numbers and an indicator variable for the thing we're actually interested in these two groups, I'll call X an indicator variable, we can write that the IQ is distributed as normal such that it's always the intercept, so both groups get an intercept, plus your delta divided by 2 times whatever your x is. And then S there. So what this means is that it actually goes through, so for IQ1, it looks at what x1 is. For IQ2, it does the same thing. I actually glossed over this aspect of things, is that you can write it as IQ with no subscript is equal to this with no subscript, and it actually automatically knows that what you want to express is that each element, it works out that, okay, if this is a vector and this is a vector, it automatically expands it so that it has, it means this. Divided by 2 times x2. And just to be a little bit more explicit, what this it would actually work out in terms of the math would be I said it was IQ. It's distributed as normal, whatever the intercept is, plus the effect divided by 2 times whatever x is, s. So that's what we actually wrote in code. Here, I wrote it out as normal because that's what the code requires. But Otherwise, that's what we had in code. And that automatically converts to, okay, so when it sees the first entry, 102, it says, okay, 102 is normal, whatever the intercept is, times or plus whatever the effect is. And it finds what the x is for this person that has 102, so times negative 1. So that's expressing that this person that had the 102 came from a group with this mean and that variability. So the times negative 1 means that this just resolves to I minus delta divided by 2, right? So for the next person, they were a plus 1, right? So for this next person, 104 gets represented. They're coming from a group with I plus delta divided by 2 times plus 1, s. So this resolves to I plus delta divided by 2, s. Is that straightforward? And then it does that for continuing on for each person. So, go ahead.
So, this way we get a whole bunch of IQs distributed as, etc.
Yeah, this distributed as starts, like, you're expressing that this person comes from a group whose mean is this and whose variability is this.
Or is in, like, model one, where you have the two different means.
Well,
top of that page. Yeah, so like, okay, so it's the same thing like all, you know, Scotians,
yeah,
just go down.
Yeah, this auto sort of elaborated that everybody who knows Scotians were distributed from a group with this single mean and a standard deviation.
It's the same thing as like doing that line by line as you're doing.
Yeah,
just
yeah. Yeah, I kind of glossed over that it auto expands when it sees a vector. It auto expands to say, okay, this just repeats. So,
but it'll match it, it'll like line it up.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. So
the other method doesn't matter at all.
Yeah. Yep.
So what output is this giving you?
So what this is going to give you, the way at least I've set this up here, kind of ruined it by putting IQ1, so I'm going to take off this subscript because I elaborated on this other piece of paper what that actually was. So having this scenario here where you say IQ is distributed as an intercept plus the effect times this indicator variable still gave you the exact same output as when we had this scenario. You had an intercept distribution, credible values for the intercept, and you had a distribution for the effect. So that was one simplification we could make. And again, that is going from having this model where it's on two separate lines and having two separate objects representing your two groups to this model where it's just one line and some math going on to combine to combine this group indicator variable x with the effect to make it say go up the effect amount for one group and down the effect amount to get to the other group.
So I'm curious to see like what do the graphs look like? I'm just trying to understand for our credible values because now we're seeing the difference is only one thing. You know we separated them, we had two distributions.
Yep.
What does it look like now?
Exactly the same.
Oh,
so
okay.
We haven't changed it. This is just changing like how we express the model. The parameterization is the same. You're
okay.
Still going to get out that original intercept, credible values, and effect, credible values.
One group, right, or two distributions where like BC and Nova Scotia.
Well, it's still by having two groups in this indicator group, in this plus one and negative one.
Yeah.
That implicitly means that this delta reflects what you should believe about the difference between those two groups.
Okay, that's what I'm wondering.
Yeah.
I have a question about that indicator variable. I kind of like, it's on the tip of my understanding why that doesn't affect the outcome of, like, so because it's negative, right, and one's positive, I understand that that's like separating the groups. But then how doesn't that influence, like, whether one is greater or...
Because you could just switch the sign of what delta is to make
it
so that...
in the data, like...
Yeah, it's going to find out what values of delta are most believable. And so if you've made it so that it's... Let me go back to this. In either case, if you've made... So here, let's deal with this. This is Nova Scotians, and it's plus this delta. It will find out that most since the data actually reflect the mean of the data is that Nova Scotians is less than BC, the mean that we actually observed in the samples. So positive values for delta are not going to be very credible. Negative values for delta will be credible because but if we expressed the model the other way around, so it was I minus, Nova Scotian was distributed as normal with I minus delta, and BC was distributed as I plus delta, then delta, negative values for delta wouldn't be very credible because the samples are such that BC is bigger than NS, and therefore positive values for delta would become credible. So it automatically figures out, given which plus and minus you chose there, what values of delta make it work out so that the peak of the prior moves towards what the sample actually says. Yes. Sorry, I guess the peak of the prior to get to the posterior is a shift of the prior towards what the sample mean actually is. So, I mean, maybe it would be useful to actually literally show you in R. Oh, well, well, what I want to show you is that if we had this original scenario, not the one. Okay. The model we had, 2 samples, 0, 2, dot, stand, was the one where we had the first instance where we had the center and diff. We didn't bother scaling or anything like that. But we did impose this decision of, like, this one group is minus diff and this other group is plus diff.
If you have that indicator variable and you, like, assign it one way or another way, wouldn't that...
That's exactly the same as what we're imposing here as a decision. We had to make one minus diff and the other plus diff. In the next scenario for model 2, we have to make one indicator negative one and the other indicator variable positive one.
But wouldn't it affect it if you switch, like, the indicator?
All it does is it flips the sign on what the delta gets estimated as.
Yeah,
it's able to figure out that, so it always starts as in terms of a credible interval, our prior always starts out as centered on 0. So it's just going to shift either to the positive realm or the negative realm, depending on what the data actually say. So that's the first simplification we had. Moving to I would call this long format, sort of data. The model is sort of expecting the data to come in as long format, not just 2 separate objects for each group, but a single equation, and the data comes in as a data entry and a list of predictors, or indicator variables there. Now, it was raised that we also realized that a slight simplification can be made whereby instead of having the model always have this delta divided by 2, if we made it so that I'll call it model 3, IQ is treated as normal. Whoops, there we go. I plus delta times x, and we were just sure to make x always negative 0.5 and positive 0.5, that took care of that divided by 2 that we would otherwise have to have in there. So we'd have, instead of negative 1 and positive 1, we'd have 0.5, 0.5, 0.5, 0.5. So that's just what we'll have from now on, is instead of negative 1 and positive 1, negative 0.5 and positive 0.5. And that just makes it so that we don't have to have this extra division here, slowing down our computation. So, but otherwise, we got the same sort of representation of the posterior as before. We had an intercept term in our posterior, or intercept parameter in our posterior that we could ask its credible intervals on. And we had a diff term or an effect term, I can't remember, I guess we used diff, in our posterior that we could talk about its credible interval on. And then I introduced you to a function in R called model matrix that seemed to make our lives more complicated, but I promised would make things simpler. So I'll actually write out the fourth way of doing things before I... So the fourth way of doing things, here again, in the third way, in the second way, IQ is a vector. And in fact, IQ is still going to be a vector of all the numbers. And x was just a single indicator variable vector. And ditto, this coefficient was just a single value. And this intercept was just a single value when we expressed it in the R. The STAN code. Here, so for number 4, we're still going to have same homogeneity of variance, though we can amend that. Here, all we're going to have is, what should I use as a symbol instead? I'll just call it C. C for coefficient times x. Now this time, maybe I won't even put x, I'll put m. So m now is a matrix, and c is a vector. For this scenario, we made it so that however many columns there are in m is the number of entries in c as a vector. So we made it so that m had 2 columns, and I'll even start drawing that. So again, we had IQ as one column with numbers all the way down. We had used model matrix to create another sort of matrix object. So IQ was actually one object that sort of is off by itself. And then we had another object that had a column called intercept that was all ones. And then it had a column called group, one. And we made it so that it had that negative 0.5 and positive 0.5. Negative 0.5, positive 0.5, etc. So it's somewhat similar to what we had before. There was, before with model 2, we just had IQ as sort of its own, it was still its own thing here. But then all we had to give it was this single thing, x. Now we're giving it IQ as its own set of numbers, but now a matrix instead of a vector. And that matrix has this one column that seems rather useless, intercept. It's just all ones all the way down. But then this other column is the same as what we had for this thing called x over here. It's just a list of 0.5s and negative 0.5s and positive 0.5s corresponding to as sort of serving as an indicator variable for what group each entry in the IQ column belongs to. So the benefit of this way of putting in, sort of inputting the data, is that we can have much more complicated models. Right now, we're just dealing with a scenario where there's just one predictor group, one group versus the other. And while this will perform the same things as before when we just have that one predictor group, this C times M, this vector times a matrix, will automatically expand to, let me actually look that up before I laud its, so this is number 4, when you have IQ distributed as normal C times MS. What it's going to do is it's going to find the first IQ value, number 1, see it as distributed as normal, and it's going to see that there's two, in the case that we used where there was the data set coming in where the M was this two column matrix, it's going to multiply the first element in C by the first element in M. I should actually say that's column 1, row 1, column 1 in M is going to be multiplied by C plus, and I'll just put it down on another thing, the second element in C times row 1, column 2 in M. And then, of course, S.
And then after that, C3 times M2, 1.
Well, right now, M only has two columns. So C only has two elements. So you multiply the first entry in C times the first row, first column of M. Then you add that to whatever's next, which is the second element in C times the first row, second column in X, M.
Right.
To elaborate that, what that would be, if we had, whatever's in this place is always 1. So that's just C1 times 1 plus, and whatever C2 is, times, and if I'm going by this matrix here, the first element in the second column is -0.5.
Do we have a C under this model yet, or is that for a future models where we have multiple predictors?
Do we have a C?
Like, what is C referring to?
C is a vector of coefficients that our stand code, we told our stand code to create as many coefficients as there are columns in this matrix.
Yeah,
so it has two columns, so there's going to be two coefficients. That's what C is. It's a list of two things.
Okay, that's like,
I'm
still understanding what those things are.
Okay, well, if let's follow this through. So this bit here works out to, again, for IQ1 is normally distributed as this, comma S. So inputting the actual values, it's C1 plus C2 times -0.5. So again, IQ1 is still distributed as normal. C1 times 1, we can simplify that as C1. And plus C2 times -0.5, we could just say minus C2 divided by 2. Does that work out to be the same? So that's what happens when the indicator variable in the second column of the matrix is -0.5. If it happens that let me do another one. If the indicator variable was positive 0.5, than like the next example. So IQ2. Well, we know that it's always going to be C1 times 1, because this is always 1. So we don't have to go through the step of adding having C1 times 1. It's just
C1. For IQ2, it's C1 times M1, 1 again, or M?
It's IQ2, it's M1, M22. So the square bracket terminology, I'm using what R does, which is the first thing is the row, the second thing is the column. So M12 is this one, M22 is this one, M232 is this one, etc. So, All right.
So it's 2, 1, 2, 2.
Sorry?
The M's for IQ2.
Yeah.
First M1.
You know what? I'm going to start on a separate piece of paper because that's getting too crowded. So let's go back through IQ1 and put that on one piece of paper, and I'll do IQ2 on the other. So IQ1, distributed at normal, and there's C1 times M1 plus C2 times M12. Okay, so that's what IQ1 is going to be. And we can actually work that out. So so this C1 times M11, well, M11 is always, M, whatever entry it is, it's always going to be 1. There's always going to be a 1 here. So we can just say, well, I'll even just put it in. So this is a 1. C2, and this one, looking up at our table, is a negative 0.5 times negative 0.5. Yeah, I forgot the S part, but you guys remember. All right, so we can simplify this a bit. This is just C1, right? And this is just C1 minus C2 divided by 2. Instead of C2 times negative 0.5, a positive C2 times negative 0.5, we can say C2 divided by 2. So again, NC1 minus C2 divided by 2. Yes, etc. So that's for the number one, for the first row in this matrix, and first element of IQ. For the next one, again, we'll have IQ2 distributed as normal. C1 times M21, second row of M, plus C2 times M22. And S over here. So look up C1. Don't have to look this one up because everything in this column of M, in the first column of M, is 1. But I do have to look up this one.
Oh, that's right. When we turn it into a matrix, it just makes that column as all 1.
Yes, yeah, the model matrix just yields a column of 1s here. But this one is a positive 0.5.
It's going to put this in for us, right? We don't have to do this every
time. Yeah, yeah, I'm just showing you like what that algebra shows you. Yeah, plus 0.5 times positive 0.5, and then S, of course. So that's C1 plus C, and this can simplify to positive C2 divided by 2. So you see that with the person that is from the one group, this math, which it's going to work out itself, has resolved to the formula we're used to. It's something, C1 is going to be our intercept now, minus something else divided by 2 for that person in one group. And it's that same something, C1 plus C2 divided by 2. So by that structure, this implies that C1 is our intercept, because it's always there for every single person. And C2 is the effect, is the difference between the two groups.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so that was really helpful and made so much sense. The only thing I'm still wondering about is Robin's question, which is what C is.
Well, C is what we, I mean, it's just like language, was what we define it to be. So it starts out being just a list of two numbers, but because we're using it in this fashion, that ends up being equivalent to saying something that we've previously called the intercept plus an effect divided by 2. C, the first entry in C is the intercept, and the second entry in C is our effect.
So the difference between the means?
Yes.
Okay. Not between each individual observation.
Yeah.
Total difference.
Yeah.
So then you make parameters as C1 and C2, just like you did for intercept. And
yeah. Difference. Yeah. So instead of now intercept and diff, we'll have coef1 and coef2. I have a nice little script that will actually automatically rename them back to intercept and diff. For you guys, or intercept and group one. Whatever your model matrix column titles were, it will automatically reapply those column titles to the output of Stan so that you can, in your the little numeric table, see it a little bit easier.
So you said this would be useful because in theory you had multiple coefficients that could predict, could serve as predictors. Right now we have group.
Me
so
telling
just,
this.
Right
stop.
Now we have like, group serving as a predictor, but that's still built into the model in the plus or minus sense. It's not built in as a coefficient, so to speak. Right?
Well, it's built in as a coefficient in the sense that, let me actually pull up the Stan code.
Since C2 is difference.
It's number 4 that we got to. Actually, let me, is it in 3 that we got there yet? No, 4. Okay, so 4 has this extra complication that we did the scaling. I probably should have done that in a separate model. But so X comes in as a matrix with some number of rows and some number of columns. In our particular case, we had an X as having 2 columns. But the idea is that it's flexible. It could be more columns, in which case that would represent more predictors. And for however many columns there are in X, it will have a vector of coefficients with that number of elements. So if there's 2 columns of X, coef is going to have 2 elements. If there's 3 columns in X, coef is going to have 3 elements. So it will automatically sees that there's need for 2 coefficients because there's 2 columns in this X when we use it in this case, but later on when we have other more effects and interactions and things like that, it will have even more entries in coef.
I think it'll make more sense to see future models. Sorry to finish this kind of that question. But right now, so X is currently equivalent to M on your paper.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
The second column of it is basically denoting which group people are.
Yeah.
In
yep. The first column of X is just the intercept, and the second column of X is the indicator variable 0.5 and negative 0.5 indicating what group each person is from.
Yeah, that this might you or that train of thought might have answered this, but I want to make sure. What is the advantage of this approach over the 2 sample 0-3 approach of just
Yeah, because this will extend to when we have more than just intercept and diff.
Cool.
If we had like a multiple regression scenario where we had 2 groups, but then age as a continuous variable, And maybe sex as another variable, and maybe we wanted to look at the interaction between group and sex. That's all. It makes it very straightforward to use this precise exact same stan file
and
just modify what we
just
give it as a predictor matrix to ask those extra questions.
So for just the looking at
Yep, it's mathematically equivalent. You get the exact same numbers, regardless of whether you do this matrix style or the earlier this intercept plus diff style.
Cool.
So, yeah.
You can only ever compare between two groups as long as we use this like plus and minus system, right?
No, you can add extra coefficients that implement a third group.
Okay.
You need to do some things afterwards to actually do anything like do all possible comparisons between groups to establish what all those different scores are. But in terms of structuring the matrix that is the coefficients, model matrix is going to do it for us. So if you had a scenario with three groups instead of two, it will have three columns in that model matrix, but it will handle figuring out what numbers it's supposed to put in that by itself. All right, I'm going to stop the recording.